flatten ears to ground, curve shoulder into the hollow of bones of earth beneath you. Hear stories travelling the roads of others, like the hum of a thousand tiny engines. Step over fence lines and valleys that hold more than water. Follow the fading shriek of siren, a sigh from another room, the conversation of birds. Do this before you leave, and our town falls away, shrinking into grid lines and patchwork paddocks, before the fingers of peninsulas and forking rivers fit inside the palm of your hand, before we are lost in the crumpled exhale, a tooth flung to the wind, and the only question left is,
did you have a good world before all of that?
Go close to the nameless streets that lead to mouths full of untapped words, tuned to the hum of a thousand tiny engines.
This is 1 Hour with I'm Raegan. Today we are spending 1 hour with Megan Albany, who is really accomplished. Megan, welcome to the show. Thank you for coming on. And I just want to point out, like, when I read your press release, now let me see, you're an accomplished journalist internationally. You were a researcher for SBS. You were a script writer. You were a founding writer for Aboriginal NITV Living Strong and a concept developer for Move It Mob Style, as well as an accomplished author, having been nominated for the Banjo Prize in 2020, and a musician putting out an album, at least one album, to go with the book that you've written. And I'm sure that I've missed a whole heap of stuff. Apologies for that. But I'm really quite mind blown. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, thank you. It makes me quite tired just listening to it all. And in fact, I think the fact that I'm a mother is probably adds, a mother of a teenager. So I think that's probably the biggest job of all, as most mothers would know. And it doesn't impress your teenager at all what you've done.
You're still daggy.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what you've done. Oh, God, that's just my mother.
So, Megan, amongst all that, I'm assuming you're Indigenous.
Yes, I'm a proud Kalkadoon woman of First Nations and European descent. I have also very strong affiliation with my beautiful Maltese side of my family on my dad's side and Kalkadoon on my mum's side.
Very much multicultural.
Yes.
So how has that influenced the person that you've become? I imagine massively.
Yeah, look, it really has. I mean, my journey has been quite an unusual one. I mean, I grew up in, I'll probably give my age away, but, you know, I grew up in an era where, you know, people weren't proud of anything, anything that wasn't, you know, very Anglo. And also my dad was called Spaghetti Eater and Garlic Muncher, and you think, wow, we don't talk, I don't know one person that wouldn't eat pasta and eat garlic now.
Right.
So it was a very conservative kind of a time, even when I was at school. And unfortunately, my Aboriginal heritage was hidden from me by my Nana, because she was from Kalkadoon, is up near Cloncurry and Mount Isa, and of course that was during the era of the stolen generation, so she never told my mum and she never told us, and she used to keep us out of the sun and try to brush our hair so it was straight, because she didn't want us to know. So we only found out after my Nana died, and bizarrely, that was when I was working for Deadly Vibe, which was an Aboriginal media company. And when I was 18, I'd gone and lived in Pidginjarran lands, even though consciously I didn't know about my heritage. And then I ended up working in Aboriginal media for 15 years, and it was during that time that, after my Nana passed, that we found out about my heritage, and I couldn't have been anywhere better for to have found out that, because my boss at the time, who's since passed, was so beautiful in kind of welcoming me back to country and helping me, you know, come to terms with how that had all been hidden and the loss of culture, and just going, I thought this was who I was, and now there's another part of me that I somehow always knew was there but didn't really know. So I guess that's influenced me quite a lot in my actions and everything since then. Mm. Yeah, and I think I'm not alone in that. There's a lot of people who are stolen gen, or in my case hidden, And, you know, it's a bit of a journey trying to figure out who you are. I think it's a bit of a journey trying to figure out who you are without that, actually.
Yeah. I can imagine that there might have been a kind of sense of coming home or becoming whole or something. How did it feel for you to discover all this?
Look, it was a fairly private thing for me for a long time, because, you know, I didn't grow up in an era where that was kind of a good thing to be in terms of, I guess there was a bit of fear around that, to be honest, and I think some of that was probably inherited from my nana, when there was a lot of fear around, you know, you don't want to tell your kids because you don't want them taken. So I think I'd somehow inherited some of her fear around that. So it wasn't a big celebration for me. It was kind of a just quiet coming to terms with, well, what does this mean to me now? And obviously now, you know, I've had almost 30 years to kind of process that and come to find peace with I guess my nana's decision not to tell us and to reconnect with culture, and that feels like very much a part of who I am now. But it took some doing, and I guess there's this thing that, especially when I found out, it was people were starting to celebrate Aboriginality a bit more, which in a weird way kind of made it a little harder, because I didn't want people to think I was doing it because it was a cool thing to do. Just part of my heritage that had been hidden, and so I needed to process that really quite privately for many years, really, and just only identify with people that I felt safe with, because there's still plenty of instances where, and now, you know, I identify with everybody, but when it first happened, I wanted to make sure that I felt safe, because I didn't feel safe having, I just wasn't comfortable with it at first, and I wasn't comfortable. I was really proud to be Kalkadoon, but it was more just I thought I was someone else, and so then I needed to work out what that meant, and that was tricky, and I didn't want other people's judgments and other people's opinion to be influencing my very personal reconnection with my culture.
Mm. All right, well, Megan's going to share three people who she would love to spend an hour with, and I have a feeling this is going to be very interesting. And also, Megan, as I mentioned earlier, you have a book. It's called The Very Last List of Vivian Walker, and a soundtrack to go with that. We'll be talking about that more later in the show. So let's kick it off.
Sensation.
This is 1 hour with, and today we're spending 1 hour with Megan Albany, who has released the very last list of Vivian Walker, and it comes with a soundtrack. Keep listening because we'll talk more about that a little later. Now, Megan is just about to start sharing the three people she would love to spend an hour with, and we're kicking off with Mae West. Why Mae?
Mae West just always said whatever she wanted to say. She was very brave and sassy, and so I particularly love that.
She was.
And I just think she'd be fabulous. I love someone who can just come out and say it. I think I was brought up, you know, to be too polite. People who know me now might go, what are you talking about? But I love how she just was, you know, she just said what she thought. And I actually just recently dug into a bit more about Mae West after we put a song on a soundtrack called Clean House, and it's based on a Mae West quote that a friend of mine had actually written a song about. And the quote is, a clean house is a sign of a wasted life. And I really loved that quote. I kind of think now, these days, we need to dig deeper into that. I don't know that it is a sign of a wasted life, but it's certainly a sign that maybe your focus has been not enough on yourself, I think. And my friend wrote this fantastic song, which was called Clean House, and I heard it, and I just love the chorus, which was based on Mae West. And I said to her, because I thought it would go really well with my book, I said, would you mind if I get your baby that you've written and done such an amazing job on, and can I change all the lyrics and make it suit my book? And she very, very graciously said yes. Her name's Wendy Ford, which is a huge thing to do, because it's like saying to someone, I love your baby, would you mind if I give them a boob job and a facelift? And they go, sure, off you go.
Coming back to Mae West, how did you first come across her?
I think I've always known about Mae West. It was probably in old black and white movies, I think, watching midday movies in the 70s, you know, on an old black and white TV. I'm sure that's probably where I first saw her. You know, when you place her in the vintage that she was from, it wasn't, you know, I don't think there were that many women who were. Obviously, there were some who had all the fabulous, you know, suffragettes and everyone who came out and the early feminists, but I don't think there were many women like her that gave people permission to just be that sassy. I can't think of all the fabulous quotes that she has, but I know there are hundreds of them, and I'd encourage people to Google Mae West quotes, because they're just, everyone's a winner.
I saw a movie sometime in the last year that she was in, and I can't remember what it was called, but she only agreed to be in it if she could write all her own lines.
And so fabulous.
It was relentless.
Look, I don't think she would have been, you know, she wouldn't have been an easy person, I don't think, in some ways. But I love people like that. I actually feel quite safe with people that say exactly what they think. You know, I'm probably more of a wheedle around, try to be polite kind of a person. And I love people that just go, yeah, nah, this is what I think, blatant. And I find that actually kind of relaxing, because you know exactly where you stand. Mm. And there is no niceties. But she also didn't just say what she thought. She said it with incredible wit and intelligence, which is, you know, what made her fabulous. So this is a song called Clean House that I wrote with my husband, Mark Mittag, and it's a reworking of a song by Wendy Ford. And it's a fabulous song, because actually, if you listen carefully in the chorus, you'll hear something that sounds like percussion, but it's actually my husband, Mark Mittag, playing the broom. Thank you.
eye you're staring at. Don't care what our life looks like from the inside. What's that about? I'm picking up things off our floor. None of them mine, they're all yours. Seems like I've done this forever, but who's keeping score? Because a clean house is a sign of a wasted life.
Wasted life.
And I've wasted my whole life with you. They say a clean house is a sign of a wasted life.
Wasted life.
And I've been so wasted. You taking out the bin. I'm cleaning your things in a rage, replaying the words that you said. Promise I'd love you to old age, but I'll strip out bed. Because a clean house is a sign of a wasted life.
Wasted life.
And I'll waste whole life with you. They say a clean house is a sign of a wasted life. And I've been so wasted. Last year, you don't notice where I have been. I hate you most when I clean. You want our house spotless, but don't care that I'm on the floor. Because a clean house is a sign of a wasted life.
Wasted life.
And I've wasted my whole life with you. They say clean house is a sign of a wasted life. And I've been so wasted.
Today, we're spending 1 hour with Megan Albany. Probably, I'd consider you a creative all-rounder, really. You've got a book and a soundtrack to go with that, and we'll talk more about that very shortly. Megan is up to person number two, who she'd love to spend an hour with. And who is that, Megan?
So the person I'd love to spend an hour with is a wonderful woman whose name was originally Rebecka Delforce, but she changed it to Rebecka Darling Darren, near Delforce.
Why did she change it?
Rebecka was an amazing friend of mine, and she started a charity in Africa called Food, Water, Shelter with her boyfriend, who became her fiancé. And he unfortunately was killed in Africa over there, and his name is Darren. So she changed her name from Rebecka Delforce to Rebecka Darling Darren.
Wow. Okay, so Rebecka was a good friend of yours. How would you like to spend an hour with her?
Look, I would just love to catch up with her. Not that she's really left me. Rebecka died of cancer. She had PTSD from after Darren had died, and she kind of wanted to die even though she was only 45. And she said to me before she died, she'd been editing. She was a journalist originally, and she'd been editing a website on near-death experiences, and she was really fascinated with that and quite excited that she was going to find out before any of us what really happens after you die, because she was quite competitive too. So, so she'd said to me, "You wait till I'm gone. It'll be so much fun." And I have to say that since she's dead, she has hung around quite a lot, and she has been, strangely, a lot of fun, even though I remember at the time saying, "Fun for who?" when she said it'll be so much fun.
What's happened?
Lots of things, and anyone who knew Rebecca will all speak to this. But one of them was, before Beck was dying, she was talking about wanting to start a publishing house, and she really wanted to tell women's stories and things like that. And when I got my publishing deal with Hachette, I was assigned two editors, and one was called Rebecca Saunders and another one was called Rebecca Allen. So she kind of, I felt like I had no choice but to go with Hachette as my publishers, because it had been ordained. And there's so many crazy stories like that, which probably make me sound like a crazy person, but yeah, she really has hung around in my life in lots of strange and wonderful ways.
So what song have you chosen to go with Rebecca?
So the song I have chosen to go with Rebecca is Devil Great Drive, and it's not because I think she's gone down to where the devil is. It's more because she was a massive Susie Quatro fan, and we spoke at one point about going to Susie Quatro was coming out to Australia, and really, really wanted to go and see Susie. Unfortunately, Beck still had her PTSD, so we never got there, but she was a kind of a rock chick, and so she loved a bit of Susie Quatro, so I'd like to play Devil Gate Drive for Beck.
Dive.
1 hour with, I'm Raegan, and today we're spending 1 hour with Megan Albany. Megan has shared the first two people she'd like to spend an hour with, and we're up to person number three, and this is a beautiful flow-through effect. Who is person number three?
Person number three is someone I'm sure most people would want to spend an hour with, and that's the fabulously, amazingly talented Stevie Wonder.
So why would you love to spend an hour with him?
Well, apart from the obvious, which is his music has been such an inspiration to me, he always manages to write about really deep topics that you want to, you know, dance to. You'll be dancing to songs about ghettos and difficult subjects but somehow feel uplifted, and I think that's such an incredible skill. But the other more personal reason I'd like to spend an hour with Stevie is because I actually performed his song As at my friend Rebecca's funeral. Despite the fact that Rebecca actually wasn't a fan of Stevie Wonder, so I still to this day go, how were we ever friends, that she wasn't a Stevie Wonder fan. But that song has a line in it which says, the rosebuds know to bloom in early May, and Rebecca was quite a fan of beautiful old roses that have the scent, and she gardened with roses. And she asked me to sing it, and she said, oh no, I like you singing it much better than Stevie Wonder, which I still to this day think is ridiculous, and I don't agree with her on that, let me just be very clear. But she did clap her hands as I was performing the songs that I was going to sing at her funeral for her, and said, who gets to do this? Who gets to listen to the songs they're going to have at their own funeral? And she was very excited and happy about it. And again, I was probably not as excited and happy about it as she apparently was. I actually have got to spend, in my life, I was lucky enough when I was 9 months pregnant, I got to spend about 2 minutes with Stevie Wonder because I got backstage. I was 9 months pregnant and boogieing, and everyone Wow. kept looking at me like, sit down because you're about to drop that baby. But my husband, Mark Michaud, was touring with Herbie Hancock's band, The Headhunters, and the percussionist from there had played and toured with Stevie. And I begged and pleaded and said, you have to get me backstage. But when we got backstage, there were, of course, lots of people waiting, and we got to say hello, and that was about all. But it was still, you know, an absolute dream come true, and got a photo with Stevie Wonder. So, you know, a minute's better than... Better than nothing, but an hour would be amazing.
So what would you do with an hour with Stevie?
Oh, look, I'd probably just be really embarrassing and fangirl and gush about how fantastic he is. And it was interesting meeting him because he's blind. And when you meet someone, I've realised how much we really do try to connect through the eyes with people. And he was sitting there playing music, and that was amazing when we met him, just having almost a little private concert. So I'd be happy to just shut up and let him talk or play or whatever he wanted to do, to be honest, because I don't think I'd be adding to his life. I'd be very willing to just sit and listen.
I love that. You've chosen As the song that you performed for Rebecca at her funeral and before her funeral, bless her. Yeah. You've chosen As your song to go with Stevie Wonder. Is that purely because you performed it for Rebecca?
It probably is. That is why the main reason I chose it, but it is also one of my favourite songs of Stevie Wonder, and it's off, you know, the penultimate Stevie Wonder album, which is Songs in the Key of Life. And the other reason I love As is because it has one of the most beautiful lyrics and most poignant lyrics that I think we all need to hear, which is, just as kindness knows no shame, know through all your joy and pain that I'll be loving you always. So here is Stevie Wonder with the very beautiful and wonderful As.
As around the sun, the earth knows she's revolving, and the rosebuds know to bloom in early May. Just as hate knows love's the cure, you can rest your mind assured. Reveal the mystery of tomorrow, but in passing we'll grow older every day. Just as all that's born is new, do know what I say is true, that I'll be loving you always.
Until the rainbow burns the star in the sky.
Always.
Until the ocean covers another day. Just as time knew to move on since the beginning, and the seasons know exactly when to change. Just as kindness knows no shame, know through all your joy and pain, and I'll be loving you always. As the day I know I'm living, but tomorrow could make me the past, but that I mustn't fear. For I'll know deep in my mind the love of me I've left behind, 'cause I'll be loving you
This has been 1 hour with, and we're just about finished. Today we have spent 1 hour with Megan Albany, who has shared the three people she'd love to spend an hour with, being Mae West, her dear friend Rebecka Darling, Darren, Nee, Delforce, and Stevie Wonder. Now, Megan is incredibly accomplished, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show, being a writer of all sorts, a musician, a producer, a researcher. But predominantly right now, we're talking about the very last list of Vivian Walker, which is your book, which was nominated for a Banjo Prize in 2020, quite prestigious, and also the soundtrack to go with that, the soundtrack of the very last list of Vivian Walker. Ooh, so I've basically done your promotion for you.
I feel very blessed with The Very Last List of Vivian Walker, because effectively it's a black comedy about a woman who's dying, but she's still got a list of things that she needs to do. And why I feel blessed with it is I kind of wrote it as a kind of catharsis, having spent time in palliative care with Rebecca. But the feedback that I'm getting from women who have cancer, or people who've spent time with people in cancer that have cancer, has been really fabulous, because people are really finding it, one, funny, which is great, a little cathartic, a little sad, but also they're really feeling heard. Like, a lot of women are saying, oh, you know, I've got cancer, but I've still got to take my daughter to school and the dog to the vet and pick up the stuff from dry cleaning. So it's been really well received from people just wanting to have a kind of more look at life that when you're dying that doesn't look like it does in the movies.
At the point of writing the book, did you consider that there would be a soundtrack attached to it at some point?
Not at the point that I was first writing it, but then got towards the end of the book, I was kind of sad, like you are when you finish a book. I didn't really want to finish with the characters yet. And so I decided, well, I've always been a musician and a writer at the same time. And so I just decided, I was speaking with my husband and we talked a lot about the book, and we've always done music together. So we just wanted to express musically what the characters were going through. We wanted funny songs and we wanted sad songs and we wanted, you know, songs about life. So so that's why we decided to do the soundtrack. And I really, really wanted to write a song called Man Flu, because, you know, I think that's a terrible, terrible thing that poor men have to go through, because their flu is so much worse than ours.
Now, along with your talents, your impressive list of talents, the musicians you've got on board, including your husband Mark, they've also got quite a list of accomplishments.
Mark has played and produced pretty well everything. He is one of these people that you want to slap that can play everything. And it's only actually one track of guitar. When people listen to it, they will think there's a bass guitarist and all sorts of things happening. But there's only one track of guitar, and he also did all of the backing vocals as well. And then we had the fabulous Matt Fell, who actually Mark and Matt went to university together, and Matt helped with the mixing and did a fantastic job to-ing and fro-ing as we, very picky people, kept coming back. And even though he's amazing, you know, Mark and him have worked together enough that they totally respected each other and they just fed off each other. And so Matt did a wonderful job of the mixing. And yeah, we're really very lucky that my husband is a guitarist, because he worked for free.
How can people get hold of the very last list of Vivian Walker, the book and the soundtrack?
You can visit my website, www.meganalbany.com, and you'll find all the details about both the book and the music. And the book is available in all good bookstores and all online booksellers. And you can also, if you happen to already have a copy of the book, just flip it over to the back cover and you'll see a QR code, which now, thanks to COVID, we all know how to use. And that QR code will take you Bandcamp to find the music.
Awesome. Megan, thank you very much for joining me today. It's been very interesting.
Thank you so much for having me. And I have a friend, a housemate, who is staying here at the moment, who just popped in to visit, who is a massive fan of your radio station. So he's going to be asking me all about it, because he just thinks you guys are all fabulous.
What a legend. Love a bit of 3D love. So that's it for today's show. This has been 1 hour with... If you'd like to be on the show, then head to Facebook or Instagram and search 1 hour with Raegan, R-A-E-G-A-N. Have yourself a great week. Go out and support our local artists, and I will catch you next Monday.